Welcome to Words of Aloha with Pastor Izzy Manzo of Amazing Grace Ministries International. We're headquartered in Kailua, Kona on the Big Island of Hawaii. Join us now as we get into God's Word.
Father, we thank you for this beautiful day. We thank you for this new year, Lord, an opportunity to serve an awesome and living God. And Lord, we pray that you would meet us right where we're at, Lord. Whatever struggles we have, Lord, we just leave all of those struggles, all those worries, Lord, at your feet, Lord. And we just pray now that you would use Pastor Izzy to speak to each one of us, to encourage us, to draw ever closer to you and to your son, Jesus. And we ask that now in Jesus' name, and all God's people said,
amen.
Amen. Okay, let's go to Romans chapter 8, guys. We were in this chapter just a few weeks ago, but we broke away to do the Christmas studies. So we're coming back to it. This is the chapter that, for your faith, this is the one. How much condemnation is there for us in Christ? None. And this is like, talk about a good study to get us kicking off the new year. You know, people trying to make their New Year's resolutions, they'll plan to do all these things, and then a couple weeks from now, they'll find out they didn't do it exactly the way they planned, and then they'll start feeling bad about it. And I'm going to just get you on the right footing to go right out of the gate, so you don't have to call me in 3 weeks. There is therefore how much condemnation for us? None. So let's not make it about that, because when you feel condemned, it makes you shut down. It just does something inside us that it closes us down. We quit functioning. We don't do well. And this is why we need to know this. This is a message that gets our spirit ready to be free to walk in what God has for us. Is that, first of all, he doesn't condemn us for our frailty. You know, the Bible says that God is mindful of us, that we are but dust. He knows our frame. He knows our frame is not strong. I mean, why would he have to send a Savior to save us if we could have done it on our own? If we were so strong and powerful? Because we can't. And so Paul has been explaining that, you know, he said, oh, wretched man that I am. At the end of the previous chapter, who would set me free from this body of sin and death? I'm stuck in this body that is not perfect, and I don't do it all right. But what was his answer at the end of chapter 7? Thanks be to God through Christ Jesus our Lord. So on the one hand, he said, on my one hand, with my mind, I'm serving the law of God. On the other hand, he says, I still got my flesh. Anyone can give an amen to this? As long as I've been a Christian, this silly battle between the flesh and the spirit has gone on, and it never stops. You know, the spirit saying, do the right thing, and the flesh is going, not only if it's convenient, you know, or maybe not because I just don't really want to. I mean, the flesh only is interested in serving itself. And this is one of the things we just sang the song, if you want to be great in God's kingdom, what do we have to learn? By the way, I'm glad it says learn to be the servant of all, because it's something learnable. We can learn by looking at Jesus' example. Jesus laid down his life for others, and we can do the same but when we look at that. And today, to set you up for getting off to a good start to your new year, I want you to key in on this, because we went over the first half of this chapter already. How Paul says there's no condemnation for us now who are in Christ. God already took care of the penalty of our sin when he sent his son Jesus to die for us. So that's covered. Now we get a new option. We get an option to walk in the Spirit of God and overcome the flesh. And we went over this a couple weeks ago. I called it the white dog and the black dog. You know how within us we got that spiritual side, the white dog, and you got the black dog, the fleshly side, and they're always going to go like a dog fight. They're going to get in the battle. But we went over a secret. How do you set it up so, I mean, first of all, older believers, help out. Do we have this battle on a regular basis, the flesh and the spirit? Do they go at it? It's like the dog fight goes on in between us every day. You know, it's the dogs are getting ready to go in the ring from the moment we wake up. Some of us, it's starting right when we're still in bed. You know, the flesh and the spirit are duking it out. And if you want to set it up for success, that you will overcome the flesh, you need to be careful. We went over, you need to be careful. Which dog do you feed? You know, if you feed the white dog, that spirit, you feed your spirit all the time. And you starve the carnal things of your life. You don't feed those fleshly desires. You don't sow into those things. Then when the two go into the ring, I don't care. Because I know that if that white dog is, boy, it's been fed and it's been exercised and it's ready to go. And I've been starving the black dog. And I haven't been feeding my flesh. And when the spirit and the flesh finally, that moment comes where they go into the fight, I know which one will overcome. It's something that works every time. This is, and Paul is saying, we have now this freedom to overcome. It's a beautiful thing to know. Before I was a Christian, I never thought, hey, I can actually overcome my sin. In fact, I don't have to sin. That was really novel to me. I mean, I don't know about you, but I didn't wake up saying, hey, I wonder if I might not sin today. You know, I might walk in the Spirit and overcome those fleshly desires. I woke up going, how much sin will I do in which topics, you know? Favorite pet sins, you know? I didn't plan on not being. I didn't even know it was an option that you wouldn't sin. That there was actual life available to me. Remember Jesus said, I came to give you life. And what did he say? And to give it to you what? More abundantly. He came to give us more abundant life. And more abundant life means a life where we're not trapped by the things that, you know, the flesh sometimes gets me in a pickle. It gets me to do stuff that gets me in trouble. And it's so nice to know that I now have an option to overcome that. I can walk in the Spirit and not go there. And that, by the way, is very freeing. Who can give an amen to that? Is it freeing to walk in the Spirit and not have to do the flesh? The bidding of the flesh, you know, the flesh is like saying, come and do this sin, come do that. And how many of you ever felt like that where sin is tempting you, is beckoning, come. And you're like, I know I shouldn't do this. And then you fall for it, right? And then you're like, oh, then you kick yourself because you fell for it, because you knew better anyway. When we walk in the Spirit, life now has a whole new dimension. It's not a bondage of life. It's a freedom. It's a life. What Jesus came to give us, that abundant life, more abundant. And Paul is describing this now. And he said, if you'll turn with me to verse 12 of chapter 8 of Romans, we're going to pick up here this morning. It says that, he said, so then, brethren, we are under obligation no longer, not to the flesh, to live according to the flesh. For if you're living according to the flesh, what did we study 2 weeks ago? You must what? You must die. But he says, but if by the Spirit you are putting to death the deeds of the flesh, then you will live. This is where I don't have to be governed by those deeds of the flesh anymore. I can actually have freedom to say, you know, I'll pass on that. I can use this, what Paul is describing, this power of the Holy Spirit. Now listen to the next verse. You're going to love this. It says, for all who are being led by the Spirit of God, these are the sons of God. Now I love this because 1 John, when John wrote the epistle of 1 John, he explains all these things about how can we know that we are truly sons of God. And he gives us different pointers that let us know this. And this is one of them, is that we have been given God's Spirit. It's a gift given to us. And, you know, the Spirit of God is there to help us with all the stuff that we face. And we can struggle with stuff, and God's Spirit is always on the job. In fact, when Jesus was about to leave the earth, his disciples, they were all bummed out. No, don't go, you know. And he's like, I tell you, it's to your advantage I go. Remember in John 14, he says, I have to go. If I go, I can send you a helper, the Holy Spirit, and he'll be with you. See, when Jesus came to this earth, he humbled himself into that. It says God took on human form, flesh. But the problem with that is he could only be in one location at a time. You know, he had to lay aside his godly attributes to come and humble himself so we could have that age-old question. If God is really real, why doesn't he come down here and show himself? And what's the answer? He did. He sent his son here, and he's called Emmanuel. We just celebrate that. God with us. So he did come down, but Jesus said, it's to your advantage. I go because I'll go to the Father, and I shall send you the paraclete. That's the Greek word for para means with, and clete is comforter or helper, one who comes alongside and is with you. Like, you know, that you know how it is when you feel all alone and someone comes up and goes, hey, don't worry about it, I'm with you. We'll get through this together. Well, that's what the Holy Ghost does for every one of us in our spiritual journey. He comes and says, I'm with you. But he's not limited to one location. He can be with you and with me and with Mary and all. He can be every single one of us all at the same time. That's why Jesus said, it's to your advantage. I go to the Father. Look, in my Father's house, he says, there's many mansions. I go to prepare a place for you, right? And don't worry. I'm going to come again to receive you to myself so that where I am, you will be also. Now, that's just, awesome news to remember that we have a mansion away. And, Jesus was a carpenter when he was down here because, you know, Joseph was a carpenter. But can you imagine what the Son of God can do when he's up in heaven? I kind of drool just thinking about a mansion made by Jesus, eternal in heaven. And he's saying, you know, some people ask me, why do you believe Jesus is coming again? I said, because he said so. I didn't make that up, by the way. It's not some new teaching. You know that the early church, they believed that the Lord would return. In fact, some of them, there was the Apostle John, who they tried to boil in oil. And it didn't work. It was kind of like when they threw those guys, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, in the fiery furnace, and they didn't burn. They tried to boil the Apostle John. This isn't recorded for us in the Bible. This is recorded in the history books of the day, that they had this religious guy. He was talking about this some guy that died and he claimed was alive and risen, and they tried to shut him up, and no one could shut the guy up, and he just wouldn't quit talking about it, and they finally sentenced him to death by boiling him in oil, and they put him into the oil, and you know what happened? He's in the jacuzzi like, hey, guys, really nice, you know, and he didn't burn. It was the same as those guys in the fiery furnace. Not even, it says, the smell of smoke came on their skin. You know, God protected John. Well, they got so mad, and they went, we can't kill the guy. Banish him to the island of Patmos. That was like the penal colony island, you know, like a little teeny island. They stick him out there on the island. Get rid of this guy. And they shoved him out. And by the way, that's where he wrote the last book we have of the Bible. The Spirit of God gave him the book of Revelation to pen for us, which is just awesome. Which talks about Jesus coming back, by the way. That he is going to come back. But see, before Jesus departed, Peter got in a discussion with Jesus, and Jesus said, Peter, before the night's over, you're going to deny me three times. Not me, Lord. I would never do that. Before the cock crows twice, you'll deny that you knew me three. Not me, Lord. And then, you know, Jesus went on and told Peter later that you just read the last parts of the supper account. And he said, and when you're older, Peter, people are going to lead you by the hand where you don't want to go. You're still going to be serving me, but you ain't going to have the freedom what you. And you read about Peter, how his days ended. He actually was taken to, they were going to crucify him. And he said, I'm not worthy to go out the way that they, crucified my Lord. So do you remember what he asked? Yeah, could you please turn me upside down? I'm not worthy to die the same way my Lord did. And they obliged him. They crucified Peter upside down. Well, when Jesus was telling Peter they would lead him where he didn't want to go, you know, some people, they know that he's referring to his death, because Peter says, well, what about this guy? Like you're telling me what's going to happen to me, Jesus. But you know how we are. We always want to know, well, what about the other guy? So what's he do? What about John? He says, that's none of your business. He says, what if I want him to remain till I return, then who cares? It's none, like, the answer is you don't get to know that. Well, it says the saying went out that John wouldn't die until the Lord returned, because Jesus didn't tell him when John, you know, what John's demise was going to be. And when they tried to boil him in oil, everybody, that just kind of reinforced the story. And so it kind of like spread that John the Apostle will be alive until Jesus returned. The truth is John died on the island of Patmos of old age. But we you know, that's how we think. What about the other guy? And Jesus says, that's not for your concern. But Jesus was teaching them he would return. But see, we forget. He says, I'll return to receive you to myself, so that where I am, you may be. I got mansions waiting for you. Anyone here want to go get a mansion? I mean, does this sound good? To have a heavenly mansion? Now, I want you to keep that in mind, because I know the Apostle Paul knew of these things. And I know that he had a perspective that we need to adopt to start our year off. It's found in the next few verses of Romans chapter 8. It says right here, for you have not received, verse 15, a spirit of slavery leading to fear again, but you have received a spirit of adoption as sons, by which it says we cry out, Abba, Father. Abba in Hebrew is, we would say, Dada. It's a very personal, endearing term. It means daddy or Dada. It's not really daddy. That's more polished. It's like when the little one just learns to say the very first, you know, syllables, Dada. That's the littlest one can cry out to their father, Dada. And the father goes and picks up the little one. He says, that's what we get to do in our relationship with God. We can cry out to him, Dada, you're my father. Now, some of you, maybe you didn't have good earthly parents. Don't worry. You get to upgrade. You get one spiritual heavenly father, best guy on the planet. Better than any guy on the planet. And it says, and the spirit of himself is, I'm sorry, the spirit himself testifies with our spirit that we are now children of God. And it says, and if we're children, listen to this, then what else are we? Heirs. What's an heir? You know, heirs are the people who inherit the stuff that the parents have, right? I mean, if you're heirs to your parents' fortune, then you get the fortune passed on. Who are we heirs to? Look at this. We are heirs of God and fellow heirs with Christ. Remember, Christ is his son, so he's saying we're fellow. How do you like this? You're not just adopted as an adopted kid in the family. You're adopted, and you get to share the inheritance. Now, how much does God have to dole on, to pass on? He owns everything. I mean, all the universe fits in the span of his hand. He goes, I got it all. Got the whole world. Remember that we used to sing that? In his hands, he got the, I mean, he got the whole wide world, and he goes, yep, I'm going to pass that on to my son. But it's not just to his son. It says here, we are fellow heirs with him. So all this is coming our way. Now he says, and this is why I want you to grasp onto this. How much do we have to look forward to? A mansion in heaven, an inheritance with Christ of all that God wants to pass to us. I mean, we're set up pretty. I know some of you come from a little bit rough times down here. This is why you need to have kind of a long-term perspective. When I say long-term, I mean eternal. You know, the eyes of the Spirit let you glimpse past this life. And there is no doubt we're leaving this earth. I mean, I posted on, if you want to just look on our Facebook wall, I shared the link, what Greg Laurie just shared yesterday, about the probability of each person dying. He said it is a one in one, you know, the statistical odds that you're not getting out of here alive is that we're going to, you know, we're all going to face death. He's like, look, and he was, of course, he's in California, so he's using all the movie stars that are dying all of a sudden this season. And he's like, it's just a reiteration that we're leaving. Now, if we know we're going to leave this earth, are you ready? Or is your perspective, hey, look, I'm only here for a short time in the perspective of, I mean, how much, if I made a timeline that represented eternity, and I said, we'll just make it, my span's about 6 feet. 6 foot long, this is going to represent eternity. How much should I carve out on the timeline represents the years I spent down here? Do you know that you'd have to sharpen a pencil to, like, razor sharp and then try to make the lightest little tick, and that little, that's still too fat. That's way too big of a chunk you've carved out on that timeline, because our span, even if you got 90, 100 years, it's a little teeny slice of this huge thing. Let's put it in perspective. We're not here that long. But where we will be there for a long time. We have something to look for. And, you know, we ain't going to be broke. I know that. I mean, we got a mansion. We are no mosquitoes, she said. My wife was going, is there geckos inside? When we moved to Hawaii 25 years ago, we thought the birds were in the house because there was this poop that looked like bird poop on the windowsills. We didn't know about geckos yet, that it was the geckos that was leaving the little... We thought there was birds coming in the house somehow when we weren't around. And we come back and then we're like, what? What? How did the birds get in the kitchen? You know, we don't see no bird. We don't hear no chirping. You know, but then we started to hear a chirping sound. And we thought that was the birds. When we finally located it, it was a gecko making this funny little, you know, and, you know, a little rat. And then my wife's like, catch it. Well, if you ever catch one, you know what happens to their tail usually. Especially if you go, see, I didn't know. I went fast. Grab them fast. They pop their tail and run, you know. And the tail sits there wiggling. That's their, a bird will go after the tail and the body will, and it'll grow back a new tail. It takes a while. We know because we saw a few of them. But then we found out my wife had at the time, this before menopause when the hands got warm, when her hands back then were ice cold, she could sneak up and put her hand on them. And because her hands were cold, they wouldn't run away. They kind of slow down. And she would just pick them up, put them outside. We call it a gecko whisperer after a while. She could just pick them up, no problem. You know, but with warm hands, as soon as you touch them, they feel you. They drop their tail and run. I was like, honey, you get them now. You know, I got to still do spiders and, you know, centipedes and those other things. That's the boy detail. Me and Daniel, we get all the scary bugs. But the gecko, she'll do. She'll take them back outside. And, you know, these things... I think, well, this is only temporal stuff. But in heaven, I got a mansion that awaits me. I have, the Bible teaches, I have a body not made by human hands, made by God. Eternal in the heavens, it says in 2 Corinthians chapter, the end of chapter 5 into chapter 6, tells us that this mortal body, what we dwell in now, is going to be swallowed up by immortality. This corruption will be swallowed up by incorruption. I'm upgrading to a new body. Forget that I have a mansion. I think that's the real mansion, by the way. The true mansion is that this spirit is no longer going to be inside this shell, what Paul called a tent. I won't be dwelling in a tent. Tents are for temporary hanging out. You know, if you've camped out a lot, you know tents work for a while, but after a while the zipper gets stuck and the rain fly starts leaking and it doesn't work and you're like, eh. Camping's fun for a little bit, but then you want to go home to a hot shower, right? You want to go back and get in your real bed, not with the rocks underneath the little mat that you were using. Well, guys, we're just camping out. So let's keep this perspective. He says, we are now fellow heirs with Christ. And I forgot to read you the last, well, I didn't forget, but I stopped. Halfway through verse 17, it says, if indeed we suffer with Christ, so that we also may be glorified with him. And Paul then tells us this, for I consider that the suffering of this present time is not worthy to be compared with the glory that is to be revealed. I know that there's some teachers under the banner of Christ's name. They teach, come to Christ and your life will be wonderful. You'll have no more troubles. You'll have no suffering. Is that true? That is the biggest lie. Those guys, by the way, I don't mind telling you, that's false teaching. Don't fall for it. Because Jesus said, in this world, ye shall have what? tribulation. He says, but be of good cheer, for I have overcome the world. That's the last verse of John 14, I think it's verse 26. He says, in this world, you will have to, not you might, you will. If I'm going to start you off for this year, realistically, since you're going to be making your New Year's resolutions, let me just put in a little clause that you can write to the side. You plan to do all these things, but included, you should make a little note to yourself, words of Jesus reassure us that we will have some troubles. It's not all going to go smooth. See, let's get the expectations to the proper setting so that you don't call me so much to tell me, Pastor, I thought I was going to come to Jesus and nothing bad was going to happen. I'm like, look, get real. The longer I serve the Lord, the more attacks I get. The more I try to walk in the Spirit, the more the devil seems to say, let's just see if we can keep, you know, how good you are at that. Maybe I'll throw an extra few temptations. He hasn't let up. But Paul said, I consider. Now, consider means, this Greek word for consider is I use my mind to think through. And it's the word, what gets translated in other portions of the New Testament as to think with what's called, in the Greek culture, they use different, they break down learning to, like what learning is of a child, then you become an adult, then you become a true student of a discipline. We, in our culture, we actually use the word master degree and doctorate degree for someone who has gone further in a discipline to learn it really, really well. We get that idea from the Greek language. The Greeks already thought that one through, and they have a word for it. And the word they use here, gnosko, is to come to know with a depth, like you're getting your master's degree. So could I start you off this year with some really higher thinking in the Lord? I want this to be like you really let this one sink in, that the present suffering, what we're going to encounter. Will we encounter present suffering? Yes. But how does it compare with the glory that is to be revealed? I mean, in higher thinking, now, you got to use your mind for this. You don't get to check your brain. Oh, I went to church, but the pastor, he's clueless. He doesn't even make you think about nothing. No. Not about that. You need to use your mind and realize, yeah, I'll suffer, but it doesn't compare to the glory that will be revealed. So maybe when you make those plans of your New Year's resolutions, you put to the side, and if I encounter any speed bumps, obstacles, trials, tribulations, problems, which we all know you will, should that stop you? No, not if your view is longer term past those things. See, we need to have that hope that looks beyond those trials. Will we make it through the trials? Did we make it through the trials of 2016? Yeah. Not quite, she said. Well, we got all 2017 to still keep going. But the only way we can keep it up and keep going and keep a real level keel spiritually is to look past the trials to the glory that awaits us. We need to be people that don't get shaken by a little trial, a little tribulation. See, Jesus, it says, for the joy set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and has sat down at the right hand of the Father. The book of Hebrews teaches us this, that this is how Christ accomplished a great hurdle. I mean, he overcame all those beatings, the rejection, the spitting on, the beating of crowns in his head, the covering of his face, the slapping of the scourging, all the stuff that they did to him. And yet it says he still kept the course. How? Because he considered longer run. He looked down the road past it to what it would accomplish. It would accomplish salvation for us. He looked beyond to the glory that awaited. And it says, for the joy set before him, the joy of saving all of us, he went through all that. Now, if he could go through all that, and he's my example, here's what I want you to do. As you encounter any troubles this year, any setbacks, anything that you struggle with, just keep thinking about Jesus. It says, consider him. Just consider. He did it. And all I have to do is consider, I'm now a fellow heir. He adopted me into the family. I'm going to get the inheritance with him. And Jesus said, all that the Father has is mine. And who did he say he wanted to give it to? To us. Man, we should maybe hold on to that. That all that the Father has is coming our way. And even though we're struggling down here and sometimes we don't get paid, and financially it's tough, and if you have your own business or you're a pastor, I got to speak to some of my fellow workers in the Lord. We go through times when there's no pay. Or we get rained out, which doesn't happen much in Hawaii, but for some reason it happened 3 times in a row. You know, not completely. We only had to go to the house 1 of the 3 weeks. But you know, that rain at the end of the service 3 weeks ago, everyone forgot to tithe because we were hurrying, scoop it all up. And I was like, Lord, I preached and everything, but am I being demoted? You know, I talked to the boss, and then the next week we get rained out completely. So it's up at the house. Only a few people came up. And I'm pretty sure the year's not ending very well, Lord. Where's my focus supposed to be? I got to look at him. You're the one that provides. Lord, I need you to, give us this day our day. We're at the end of the year, coming down to the wire. Lord, it's time to close out the books, and I don't like that red number. You know what he did? 3 checks. Last day of the year. Our community credit union closes at noon. I'm like, Lord, you're really cutting it short, 11 o'clock. Go make a deposit. Oh, you just want to make me sweat, don't you? You just want to make me trust you to the... Does God ever do that to us, by the way? You know, what we call the last minute. God came through at the last minute. Yeah. Well, you know, one time I was complaining about that, and he said, did you need it any sooner? Not really. But I would have liked it sooner. My flesh would have liked it sooner. But my spirit wound up staying a lot closer to the Lord. Because he knew I didn't really need it. I just needed to seek him. I just needed to stay fixed on him. And that's what we got to do. This year, as we start off this year, we have to be fixed on the glory that is to be revealed. So that we can put up with the stuff that we go through in the in-between time. We can't let our whole joy and hope of our faith be swallowed up just because we have some trials and tribulations. That's too short-run thinking. That makes us like too, oh, woe is me, it's a bad day. Instead of, hey, this is a really temporal, small amount of badness compared to what I got awaiting. And I got that for eternity. Bring it on. It's only going to suffer. The suffering, he said, I consider the suffering of this present time is not worthy. It's not even worthy to put on the scale to balance out against the glory that is to be revealed. If you had one of those old scales, you know, where they had the little teeter-totter thing with the little baskets on each side. And we put the present suffering of our day in the one side. And we put the glory of what is to be revealed in the other. Bink! That's what Paul's saying. He's going, they're not even worthy. In fact, it's not worth your time to stress out over. So why are you stressing out over it? Why am I stressing out? Because I lost sight of the other side of the scale. I lost sight of how valuable that eternal weight of glory is. I got short, you know, sighted. And does that happen to us in our faith? I mean, yeah, even the strongest believers have sometimes a struggle a little bit, a day of short sightedness. This is just a word to encourage you. Let's get back to the long-term perspective of our faith. Let's hold on to the hope that we have that will carry us through whatever we go through. Let's hold on to that so that when we go through the little stuff, it doesn't shut us down. It's just a speed hump. We just go up, get over it. I'm over it. Doesn't matter. Doesn't weigh out against what I got waiting for me. No big deal. Let's get back to the perspective the faith gives us, because that's what Paul's teaching. I mean, we have no condemnation, but we forget. We also really don't have to be worrying about this present suffering. Now, it didn't say we don't have it. It just says it's not worthy to be compared. Let's remember that for this next year. It's not worthy. Now, next week, I'm going to show you what we have to look forward to. This revealing of God's eternal plan. Paul gives us some really cool stuff. And I'll use the portion here in Romans, but also in Corinthians, if you want to do a little reading ahead. I didn't write it in the bulletin for you, but in 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and 6, if you have a little extra time to read this week in the Word, read those chapters for me. And look at the perspective. What we have now and what we have to look forward to. And you'll love it when we come back to the next part of Romans chapter. Remember, I told you, Romans 8 has so many powerful things to speak to our faith. Like you could just break them down, just a couple verses, and get an awesome, awesome daily devotional. So next week we'll get to the one about what lies ahead. The eager revealing of the sons of God. What does God want to do with us in the big picture? And I tell you, it's really encouraging to our faith. So we'll pick up here next week. If you join me, let's close in prayer. Father in heaven, thank you for your word. Thank you for the privilege that we have to gather on a beach in Hawaii and have whales join us in worship time. And thank you that we can just seek you and have fellowship with one another. Lord, I just pray as we begin this year, Lord, the first day of this new year together, Lord, send us out with your comfort of your spirit. Thank you for the gift of your spirit. If anyone know not that sweet gift, we just pray they would stick around. We could pray for them that they could partake in that wonderful gift of your Holy Ghost. And we're grateful, Lord. Thank you so much for carrying us through last year. Help us to keep the perspective for this year. In Christ's name we ask it now. In Jesus' name we pray, and everyone that agreed with me said, amen. Amen. Would you stand with me? Let's sing a closing song and send you off in the joy of the Lord.
Mahalo for joining us. If you'd like more information about us, go to our website, AmazingGraceKona.com, and click the link to follow us on Facebook. That's AmazingGraceKona.com. Mahalo, and God bless.